Hey church, and happy 4th of July weekend.
Yeah.
We hope that you had a wonderful time celebrating, whether you kept it simple and stayed in doors or in your homes, or if you went off and camped or whatever it was that you did to celebrate this country this weekend. We hope you had a wonderful time doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, a blessing was as the rain did relent. And mm-hmm. even with all the rain that we've been getting, the fire hazard was low for those that love
That's
to light
right.
off fireworks. I know
pyromaniacs out there.
Yeah, I usually end up with first degree burns on my hands. Yep. And I don't care because it's so much fun. But hope you kept it safe. Mm-hmm. And it was a wonderful time. We just wanted to start off with an announcement. I know that of change of plans, really.
Yeah.
I know that we're all accustomed right now to staying yeah. flexible and fluid and change of plans. Mm-hmm. And we want to let you know, after a lot of discussion, a lot of prayer, and some more prayer,
yeah.
that we will not be meeting in person today, yeah. later this afternoon. It's unfortunate to be able to have to...
Cancel
this, that yeah. and let you know. But when we planned this a week ago, since then we've had a surge in cases
yeah.
of COVID in our county and surrounding counties, and especially North County.
Yeah.
And we just didn't feel at peace to open up for a large gathering
yeah.
Right now. And so we're going to put that on hold. And we're going to be in communication mm-hmm. with the church on when we can meet again,
yeah.
whether it's outdoors, indoors. And we just want to let you know that mm-hmm. we are really praying and seeking the Lord. We're seeking counsel
yeah.
and a lot of discussion, a lot of thought is being put into how we move forward.
Mm-hmm.
And we just appreciate your patience
mm-hmm.
and we appreciate your understanding, as I know that we're all in this together.
Yep.
And one thing that we did want to express is
yeah.
the main reason that we wanted to get together, because we know that it's 4th of July weekend, a lot of you are out of town,
mm-hmm.
a lot of you are camping, a lot of you have plans, but one of the main reasons is for those who are feeling isolated right now, those that don't have plans, those that are going through a challenging time and are in that place. We know a lot of you are. We wanted to provide a space where you could connect and that you could feel ministered to.
Mm-hmm.
And we still are committed to that. That's what the church is for,
yeah.
is that we can minister one to another. And
yeah.
so although we can't have a large gathering and accommodate that way,
right.
If you're going through a hard time right now, if you're feeling isolated, we would love for you to let us know.
Right.
You can email us. You can go to our website, info@mychurchbellingham.org. And then we'd love to schedule a time
yeah.
to either come have a visit, a pastoral visit with you, or schedule a time where you can come this way.
Yeah.
But we really had a word a couple years ago, seeking the one, where
yeah.
it says in the Bible that Jesus left the 99 to seek the one, and
yeah.
that's the heart of the Father. And so
yeah.
if you're that one, we are asking the Holy Spirit to
yeah.
lead us to connect with anyone that's in need at this time, and that you would let us know. And I just want to put a challenge out there to
yeah.
the entire church that we need to be there for each other in
yeah.
this time. It's inconvenient that we can't meet or gather the way that we usually do, but we should not stop being the church.
Yeah.
And so let's all pray who we can seek out.
Yeah.
I believe the Holy Spirit
mm-hmm.
will drop a name, will let us know, will prompt
yeah.
Who we can be there for in this very difficult, challenging time. So
yeah.
We love you, my church, but we wanted to give you that update, and
mm-hmm.
We'll keep you posted on further events
yeah.
as we move.
Absolutely. And this week and or today is Communion Sunday. So why don't you gather what you have, and we will have communion at the end of the service.
Yeah.
So let's enter into a time of worship together and just really seek God's face this morning.
Lord, we just come to praise you today. We thank you, Lord, you are our King and you are our God. And Lord, we have been created to worship you, to give you praise. So right now, Father, we just turn our affection, we turn our gaze upon you. We just pray that you would fill this room, Lord God. Fill every home, Lord, with your presence as we worship and as we praise. Lord, we will lift our voice to you because you are worthy. I sing praises to you. praises to your name, a name that's so much higher than all names. We sing honor and honor to to your name.
Back and you call it my victory. your truth. Your mercy is the shade I'm living in. You restore my faith and hope again. And all I did was
kids everywhere, and happy Sunday to you. I'm coming to you live from the Kingdom Kids News Desk, where it is a beautiful day and the sun is shining somewhere. Today's topic, we're going to talk about how together we can... Wait just a moment, something's coming in. Okay, it appears we have some breaking news. There are talking animals outside the church building right now, and my co-anchor Beck is already on the scene. Over to you, Beck.
Thanks, Alyssa. I've just arrived on scene, and it looks like we have a couple of animal friends here having a picnic. So let's go say hi and find out what they're up to. Hey, Harry, what are you up to, and who is your new friend?
Oh, hey there, Beck. I do have an awesome new friend. Her name is Lola. She's the coolest snail ever.
Nice to meet you, Lola. How did you and Harry meet?
Well, I was practicing some new tricks on my skateboard when some crazy squirrel...
crazy awesome squirrel.
Right, super cool. Came running over saying he had really good news to share with me. The church had free ice cream. It was left over from a barbecue, and it was going to melt, and asked if I wanted some. Obviously, I said yes, and now we're friends.
Yeah, we ate one ice cream bar each. I found out Lola lives in the tree just around the corner. She loves ice cream, obviously, music, moving fast, and she's been thinking about coming to church.
That's so exciting, Harry. But have you shared the other good news with her?
What other good news? Wait a second. Is there more ice cream I don't know about?
No, silly. The good news of the gospel. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him would have everlasting life."
Oh, that good news.
That's right.
That Jesus wants to live life with all of us, and he loves us so much, he's there through the good times and the bad, even if we can't see him. Jesus is the best friend we could ever have.
I want to believe in Jesus and be his friend, but how do I do that?
Well, we pray, and we ask him to forgive our sins and for Jesus to come into our heart. Then we have an epic dance party, because that's worth celebrating big time.
That's right, and you live every day for him. You praise him, you share the good news with your friends and your family, and of course, the good news of, well, the gospel, and maybe even ice cream.
Beck, would you lead us in prayer so Lola can know Jesus too?
Absolutely. Why don't you close your, well, I guess you can't close your eyes. I'll close my eyes. Okay, here we go. Thank you, Jesus, for bringing us together. We thank you for your forgiveness. We thank you that you make us new from the inside out. And Lord, we just ask that you would come and live in our hearts and that we could live every day for you. There we go, guys. Amen.
Woo! Amen.
Congratulations, yeah. Lola.
Awesome, yeah. Lola.
Well, there you have it, Kingdom Kids. Together, we can share the good news. Back to you, Alyssa.
Oh my God, are we live? And there you have it, folks. We can share the good news and make friends in the process. Until next time, this is Kingdom Kids News, signing off.
Well, hey again, I'm excited today because today we are going to introduce a brand new teaching series titled The Unchained Gospel. We're going to be looking in the New Testament. We're going to be looking at biblical figures in the New Testament where they have endured mistreatment, persecution to the extent of being chained and imprisoned for the sake of the gospel. Next week, we're going to look at John the Baptist. We're going to go through Peter, the Apostle John. We're going to look at Paul and Silas, and finally look at Christ himself as he is arrested. He is bound before he endures the brutalization of the cross and conquers sin and death through the resurrection. And today we're going to have more of an introductory message on the topic of persecution. Look at biblically and historically how the church is very familiar with persecution and suffering. In 2 Timothy 3:12, it says, "Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." Now, notice it doesn't say may be persecuted, but will be persecuted. And you might be hearing this and you'd be thinking, with all that I'm dealing with right now in this time, how are we going to handle a whole series on the heavy topic of persecution and suffering for Christ? Really? Really are we going to do this? And the answer is yes, we definitely are going to dive into this head first. And I believe that many of us shy away from the topic of suffering
and persecution because of fear. And I'm excited as we dive into this that we're going to see biblically and through the testimonies of these figures that there is nothing to be afraid of for those that are in Christ Jesus, and that the power that is in us is greater than is in the world. Luke 21:12, Jesus prophesies, "Before I return, they will seize you, they will persecute you, they will hand you over to the synagogues and put you in prison, and you'll be brought before kings and governors, all on the account of my name." It's important to factor that scripture into our eschatology because Jesus has not returned yet, and he prophesies what will take place to us and to the church. But take courage. And Jesus' parting words in John 16:33, where he says, "I have told you these things that in me you may have peace." So I'm telling you what's going to happen to you. I'm telling you what the church is going to come up against. But I'm telling you these things so that you may have peace. For in this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Amen. And so if you've got your Bibles with you, we're going to turn to 2 Timothy 2:8, and this is going to be our constitutional scripture for the entire series, where Paul is in prison in 2 Timothy, and this is his second imprisonment. His first one, theologians and historians describe that he's more of on a house arrest, but in his second imprisonment, he is confined, he's in a dungeon, and this is before he's executed under the rule of Nero, and he's writing to his spiritual son and to the churches in 2 Timothy. And if you want to go there in your Bible, 2 Timothy 2:8-9, it says, "Remember, Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel, for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But God's word is not chained." And we'll go into verse 10 here a little bit. "Therefore, I endure everything." In other words, he's saying, although I'm in prison, although I'm confined, although I'm in chains, I'm being brutalized and treated as a criminal, there is nothing that my oppressors can do to contain the power of the gospel that I carry. Come on, some of you need to hear the words that Paul is saying. This is like a William Wallace type Braveheart statement that you can do. You can take our lives, but you'll never take our freedom. And I really believe that many need to hear this statement because so many believe their faith is fragile, that their faith is vulnerable, and they're afraid of any type of persecution or testing, that they may lose their faith, treating their faith almost like this endangered species. Yes, valuable, but if it was to endure any type of hardship or another hard winter that is at the brink of extinction, and there couldn't be further from the truth, that your faith is living and active in you, and that God has placed in us as believers the power and the answer to overcome the world, that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And some of you need to hear that you're more ready for the testing than you even realize, that your faith is not made of glass, that what you have contended for and what you have walked through, that you're ready for the testing. And when you step into that and you realize that God's power is real, you'll understand the peace that Christ is talking about. "Fear not, for I've overcome the world." Church, we need to know the overcoming power of God. And we understand that through the experience of opposition and persecution. And as Paul says, "Hey, I've been beaten, I've been left for dead, I have been flogged and put in prison. Nevertheless, there is nothing that man can do to me to contain this gospel." There's no chains, there's no imprisonment that you can put on this gospel. I love how some translations say that you cannot lock this gospel up. And as the Bible says, "What can the world do to me? For we hold the power of the gospel." Come on, let's pray together. Lord, we just thank you right now that you're stirring up faith in your church today, in this moment, in this hour. And Lord, as we dive into the Word of God, as we look at these testimonies of faith and perseverance under trial, Lord, let us Be like James says in James 1:3, let the opposition and the testing have its perfect work so that we will receive the reward and lack nothing. I pray right now that you would deal with intimidation. You would deal, Lord, with fear. And God, we would know the power, the dunamis power of the gospel that is in those that believe and for those that are in Christ Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Well, over the last couple of months, I have been asked on a few occasions, do you think the church is experiencing persecution right now? And that question has been inspired out of what has taken place in the last several months with restrictions on religious gatherings and really the chaos and the unrest that's taking place because of COVID-19. And my answer to that is twofold. Number one, answering with the question that if we were to interpret restrictions on gatherings and different things that are impacting us right now as a church, as a local church, if we were to interpret that as persecution, then we would need to conclude that restaurants and coffee shops and small businesses are being persecuted as well because they are under some of the same restrictions that we are. And then my second answer is, I believe that we are experiencing persecution and opposition, and that we always experience persecution and opposition to our faith constantly. That there is this force, as the Bible says, this evil force that's coming against. There's a spirit of unbelief. There's somebody that is assigned to discourage and to disrupt and to tempt and come against the church. Even in the American church, in a Christian nation, there is that. But I do not believe that we are experiencing persecution or that we are experiencing a opposition as other nations do, as other lands do, that I personally traveled to and seen firsthand, like in Indonesia, where people travel on foot miles and miles to get to a service, or in Morocco, where it's illegal to gather in certain religious gatherings. And when we were there, we were even followed by government agents to make sure that we weren't proselytizing the gospel. And so I do not believe that the American church is experiencing the persecution to that level, although we do experience opposition. What I do believe is that the church is not being persecuted right now in America more than it is being inconvenienced. And that there is a great inconvenience that is taking place in our culture, and that because convenience is a god in our culture, it has disturbed us. And disruption isn't really a bad thing. And perhaps there is a divine interruption to the status quo in our time and in our nation right now that we need to look at. Maybe God is dealing with something. That's been a prayer, that's been a conversation that I've had as we've wrestled with the challenges and the circumstances of gathering and what is church as we know it, and can we open up the building, or how do we open up the building, and have had to stop and have to pray, God, are you dealing with something right now? God, are you actually interrupting the status quo that we have been going through for years and years and years, and you're trying to teach us something in all of this? And my prayer is, Lord, don't let us gloss over this, and don't let us go through until we've understood and we've taken heed to what you're trying to communicate to us right now in this time. I want to pick on the American church for a second. We can pick on ourselves for a second. Convenience, traditions of men, and partisan politics, where a bias is more committed to an ideology of a group than it is to the way of the kingdom. Idols. Are there idols that are being shaken right now in our time and in our church? Lord, if they are, deal with them. Deal with the limitations. Deal with the boxes that we've put. Disrupt them. Our box of what we have limited the church to, where we have limited to just a Sunday morning gathering and it couldn't exist outside of them. And now we're in a place where we're forced to exist outside of that. I can remember years back when I was in my early 20s where God started to disrupt the box that I had put his church in. And I was living in Sydney, Australia at the time. And I was a part of an incredible church called Hillsong Church. And let me tell you, most of you know, it doesn't get more epic than Hillsong Church as far as how they do worship and how they preach and how they run services. And me and my roommate were at this this conference at the time, and it was over a weekend, and Hillsong United was there, and they were leading worship, and they had all the production, they had the lights and the preaching and the thousands of people, and it was stimulating and it was incredible. And we got done with one of the nights, and as we were walking outside of the church, we ran into this young man who was outside the church, and his name was Jono. Now in Australia, they like to give everyone nicknames, and so they shorten everything. But if your name is already short, then they will lengthen it. So his name was John. They call John's Jonos. And so Jono had traveled to Sydney, and he didn't have a place to stay. And he was displaced for the night. And so he said, "Hey, do you guys have a place that I could stay?" And we thought, you could stay over at our house for a night. And we hopped in the car, went to our apartment. And as we were going there, we realized that Jonah was on a journey, and he was on a journey seeking and looking for faith and really seeking for God. And so I thought to myself, fantastic. Tomorrow there's a wonderful conference at Hillsong. Let's take Jonah to this conference. Let's minister to him. Let's let him be in that worship setting. Let's let him hear the anointed message of the word. And he's for sure going to get touched by God and connect with what he's searching for. And so we got to our apartment. It was late. We'd already been, at the service, and the day was coming to an end. And my friend Keith was talking to Jono, and as he was talking to him and I was kind of getting ready for bed, he came to me and he says, "Hey, Jono's asking a lot of questions about God. I can just see he's right at this point of experiencing and encountering Jesus in a new way." And he says, "Why don't you grab your guitar? We'll have some worship here and we'll pray and let's minister to Jono." And I stopped for a second and I thought, why would I grab my guitar when we could actually just take him to church and he could have a much superior experience of the whole Hillsong United band and the anointed preachers and everything? This is going to be quite anticlimactic with me grabbing my guitar and us doing this right now. And it started to just disrupt my box, and it disrupted just my paradigm of church and how things fit. And so Keith was very persistent, and Keith was an evangelist, and so he had kind of locked on to something, was sensing something that I wasn't, and so he wasn't taking no for an answer. And so I grabbed my guitar kind of reluctantly, and it was a little out of tune, and I began to strum. And as I began to play and we began to sing just this simple chorus of "Our God is an awesome God," I'll never forget, the power of God filled our apartment complex, our apartment room right then and there. And we were all taken back by it as we started to sing and understand that the Lord was in our midst. And from there, we began to pray for Jono. And let me tell you, Jono had an encounter with Jesus that night. And we prayed for him, and he was baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. I was blown away. And I walked away from that moment and that night completely challenged in my paradigm and my view of the box and the limitations that I put God, the gospel, and faith in the church. And from that day forth, I purposed in my heart that I would never limit the power of God, the message of the gospel, to just an institution or just to a program service or just to a place or a location, but that God's kingdom is dynamic and God's gospel is everywhere, and those that carry his spirit and carry his light have the power and the authority to release it. And I really believe right now, church, that we're in a time where we need to realize the power, the authority, and the gospel and the faith that we carry, and not be limited by the boxes and the old traditions that we have seen and grow up in, but say, God, your gospel is not chained. Your gospel is not limited to what maybe man has put on it. But even if I'm suffering, even if I'm displaced, even if I'm in prison, even if I'm in a different area or I'm dealing with limitations that I've never had before, your gospel and your power and your spirit is not chained and not contained. And God, I want to release on earth as it is in heaven right now. Church, I believe that's the hour that we're in, and that is a principle that God is wanting to see take place. It's true that church has not been convenient for the last several months, and we haven't been able to gather in the convenient and accessible way that we have, but the church has not skipped a beat. Where two or three are gathered, God is there in their midst. Whether you're worshiping on the mount or you're worshiping in the temple, as Jesus says to the Samaritan woman, God seeks those who worship in spirit and in truth, and it's not confined to a location, to a time, or a service. Those things are all great and they're helpful, but they're subservient to the actual power of the gospel that is out in the streets, out in your room, in your apartment complex, where you can gather with a neighbor, you can gather with a roommate, you can gather with a friend. And you know what? I've been personally challenged to contend more for connection, contend more for church, to say, hey, I need to contend for the power of God working, for the word of God being nourished to my spirit. And if I can't get that in the usual way, Lord, show me how. Show me how. I've always made it a personal challenge for me. God, what if I was in another nation where I was being persecuted? What if I was in a place where I had to endure these things that we hear the church, the persecuted church is, or we read about in the Bible? How would I react? How would I do? God, I pray that I would be found faithful. God, I pray that I would lean in and I would see the power of your word manifest in my life and I wouldn't shy back. And I really believe we have that opportunity right now to say, God, let's see our faith work. Let's see our faith in action. Lord, if you're really trying to teach us something in this moment, if you're giving us a divine interruption, Lord, let us take heed. Let us not be distracted and think and attribute it to something else when it's really something that God may be doing. Let us pray. Let us humble ourselves and let us understand. But most of all, let's take heed to what Paul is saying, that his gospel cannot be chained. His gospel cannot be contained. And Lord, let me not be the one that contains it in my own mind, but be a release and a conduit of your power and your word. I want to close this message with a prayer, and we're going to take communion together and submit our time to the Lord here on Communion Sunday. But if you bow your heads with me and pray in agreement, Lord, we just submit, God, our church to you. We submit, Lord, our faith walk to you right now. And we ask, Lord, that you would speak to us. Lord, I pray that you would challenge us. God, I feel like many of us, maybe we feel like we've been stretched and we've been challenged, we've been tested enough. But we know, Lord, that you don't tempt us beyond what we can handle. And God, if there's things that need to be removed, if there's things that need to be surrendered, God, give us the humility and give us the awareness to surrender those to you and say, God, take the limitations off. Take the paradigms off that maybe I put. Take the traditions off that maybe don't need to be there. Bring us into the power of your gospel as you have designed it, Lord, as we read about. I pray for anyone that is experiencing opposition or suffering. I pray for encouragement. I pray for peace, Lord, that you promised. And I pray, Lord, for a thriving inner man and spirit right now that would be feasting on the Word of God, living on the Word of God. I pray right now, Lord, there's sickness, Lord. If there's anxiety, Lord, if there's needs represented, Lord, I pray for your gospel answer and I pray for healing in Jesus' mighty name by your power. And finally, right now, Lord, we come to the table, Lord, we observe your body. And if you're have something handy just to take as a symbol of the body of Christ. Lord, we take this symbol, Lord, this wafer or this bread or this cracker, Lord, we take this, Lord. And we thank you for your broken body, Jesus. We thank you for what you endured so that we could be made whole. Lord, I pray for healing on the body of Christ, healing on your body. I rebuke divisions, and I rebuke, Lord, disconnect. And I pray you bring it together. Lord, your body was broken so that we could be made whole. And we believe that and we pray that in Jesus' mighty name. We take this bread in remembrance of you, in Jesus' name. And right now, Lord, we take the cup that represents the new covenant. We take the cup of the shed blood of Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, that your blood is more powerful. Your blood has the power to cleanse. Your blood has the power to heal. Your blood has the power to wash and forgive sins. We ask right now you to wash us in the blood. Lord, we'd understand that's what connects us to one another. It's the blood of Jesus. We take this cup in faith and we thank you for it. Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Well, thank you, my church. I'm really looking forward to digging in to this series, The Unchained Gospel. Let's take the limits off. Let's allow God to disrupt our boxes and anything that we've tried to contain. And next week, we're going to be digging into John the Baptist and his imprisonment. And I'd encourage you, read ahead and study, and let's dive into this together. I really believe the Holy Spirit has something timely and divine that he wants to speak to the church. Be blessed. We love you. God bless, church.